Cantor and Dr. Ray, thank you both very much for the music you bring to our worship service. As always, it is uplifting to come to the end of the week on a Shabbat and to hear your beautiful voice and to hear your beautiful playing. Thank you. Thank you both very, very much. I feel a little odd to tell you the truth. I mean, I should probably not be introducing Natalie Grumet. You all know her better and longer than I've been here at Temple Beth Or. And so it seems a little odd. So therefore, I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time introducing somebody who is well known, except to welcome back to the Bima one of Temple Beth Or's favorite daughters. Natalie Grumet grew up in this congregation. Became bat mitzvah, confirmation. I believe your Rogues Gallery picture is there, so we can all have a chance to gather with you and try to identify you in that picture from whatever year that was. I won't even try to guess and name ages or anything like that. But it will take us a moment. Natalie does have some pictures for us. It'll take us a moment to get a few things set up. But Natalie, please, if you will come join us here, let us welcome Natalie Grumet to our congregation, back to our congregation.
All right. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
So, I'd really like to take a moment to thank everyone for being here tonight. All of your support and love over these last 16, almost 17 months has really meant a lot to our family. Our family is so grateful for all of your prayers, donations, cards, well wishes, visits. As many of you know, I grew up in this temple, attending services, Sunday school, and Hebrew school. This really is my home temple. And, you know, I learned Hebrew here. I had my B'nai Mitzvah with my brother here. We went through confirmation, and I even had the distinguished role of playing Queen Esther 1 year. So these memories are very precious to me, as are all of you. So thank you so much. You know, shortly after Jason and I started planning our wedding, we realized one major concept that I'm sure all couples here tonight can relate to. The wife is always right. Okay, that's not really what, it is right, but that's not what I was really gonna say. What we learned was compromise. And for our wedding, we decided we could use my rabbi, who at the time was Rabbi Goldmark, and we compromised by using Jason's temple. As the day approached, I really started having doubts. Not about Jason, okay, but that we were gonna use his temple. And I realized that it's not the building that can make a moment, it is the people around you. And you all here are my community. Time and distance cannot change that. I am so thankful for all of you wrapping your arms around me during my time of despair, cheering me on, and making me feel the power of Temple Beth Or and our Jewish family. So I truly want to thank all of you for that. when I spoke to Rabbi Goldfarb about speaking here tonight, he was, of course, his amazing self, encouraging, funny, and informative. So thank you, Rabbi, for giving me this opportunity. He also went over this week's Torah portion with me, which is Ki Tisa. I was familiar with the story of Moses and him going up to Mount Sinai, getting the Ten Commandments from God, coming down from Mount Sinai to find the Jewish people worshiping the golden calf. Moses shattered the tablets with the Ten Commandments by throwing them to the ground. He went back up to Mount Sinai and he got new tablets, also dealing with the feelings of anger and betrayal. However, I never made the deeper connection of how this Torah portion relates so profoundly to my life until Rabbi Goldfarb pointed it out, as only a rabbi can. So how does an ancient Torah reading become so prevalent in modern day life to myself and possibly even you? I would really like to share tonight with you some of my most shattering moments in life that at times I thought would break me, only to find out how they built me. In August 2007, I found myself sitting across from an oncologist. I remember thinking, this is not my life. This is not my life. The thought played over and over again in my head. I was too young for this type of news. I had only been married 4 years. We had just bought our first home, started planning a family. Yet, I found myself sitting in an oncology office, listening to an oncologist go over my pathology results. Stage 2, but aggressive, he said. Fast growth rate, high reoccurrence rate, lower survival rates. It really felt as though things went from worse to worse with each sentence. I desperately wanted him to stop talking, as if not saying it would make it less true. I had been misdiagnosed for 6 months and assured I was fine, despite abnormal pain and a mass. It wasn't until I insisted on an MRI and a 2-centimeter mass showed up that doctors stopped telling me I was okay. It was August 31st, 2007, and I had just celebrated my 27th birthday. The month of September, it became a whirlwind of doctor's appointments, imaging tests, and procedures. A bone scan to check my bones for cancer. A CT scan to check my liver, lungs, and brain. A biopsy of my lymph nodes that thankfully came back negative. A port was placed in my chest to receive chemotherapy. September also meant it was high holiday time. On Rosh Hashanah of that year, I found myself sitting in this very synagogue, right over there where I'm sitting today practically. And I remember wondering if I would be written into the book of life. The words that we read every year, who shall perish and who shall live, now taking on a whole new graveness. October 1st, 2007 brought Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and it seemed every store was in pink with pink ribbons, but I didn't feel like celebrating. The next week, I received my first round of chemotherapy. By Halloween, I would be completely bald. I felt this time clock ticking away on top of me, especially in the beginning. Would I reach my 30th birthday? Would I get a chance to grow old with my husband, start a family? Would my parents be given the horrible moment of burying their child? These thoughts consumed me initially. I remember shortly after I was diagnosed, I needed to get a new pair of shoes. Really the last thing I felt like doing. As I got out of the car, I headed into the store and I thought to myself, just grab the first pair of shoes you see that are the cheapest. Who cares if you like them? Who cares if they're comfortable? Who knows if you'll even be around next season to wear them? I had to literally stop myself in my tracks in that moment. What kind of mindset is that? Sure, it was shoes, but the idea is bigger than that. I didn't know how much time I had left, but did I want to spend the time I had going for the cheesiest, cheapest options? Life is not meant to be lived by simply going through basic motions. Thriving in hope, when you were promised nothing, is everything I realized. Of course there will be hard moments. We are all entitled to have our down days. But don't you dare stay there, I told myself. The more you let yourself into the deep end, the easier it's going to be to drown. I also clearly remember a conversation with my dad shortly after I was diagnosed. While my mom and stepmom were able to be by my side for testing and diagnostic tests, my dad would often be on the phone with me afterwards and going over everything. When we spoke on the phone for the first time after getting my biopsy results that confirmed the news of cancer, I could barely speak. I was so scared, and any attempt to even talk, I knew my emotions would become sobs. As if sensing all this by phone, my dad, who I'm sure as a parent was going through his own horrible emotions, said one simple sentence that brought me so much peace. Something I would cling to on my hardest days. He told me, "You are not alone in this. We will be with you every step of the way." The power of his words settled my heart and filled me in a time where I felt very much alone. Now, of course, in times like this, you also need some lighthearted moments. My mom would sometimes take me to UCLA for appointments or testing if Jason had to work. My mom also happens to be a germaphobe. On one of these drives to UCLA, we stopped for gas. Now, as I began to pump the gas and touch the pay buttons, my mom became completely riled up that I was touching the buttons and not using a paper towel. Exhaustion and frustration set in as I turned to her and said, "I have cancer. What am I going to get at this gas station that's worse than that right now, Mom?" It was really a laugh we both needed. As each month passed, I found new strength. I made a conscious decision to stop living in fear. This was my life, and I had to live it. Whatever time I had left could not be wasted on circumstances I couldn't control. October became a significant month for me. I started fighting for my life. Each chemo infusion was my way of fighting the cancer cells. My mastectomy in March was the final part of being rid of any remaining cancer cells. Reconstructive surgery in November was rebuilding what was taken from me. That year of my life would be filled with diagnostic tests, 6 rounds of grueling chemotherapy, low blood counts needing painful injections to increase my white blood count, mild congestive heart failure, a bilateral mastectomy, and reconstruction. But piece by piece, I had to learn to put myself back together again. One of the biggest things that helped me was connecting to other people going through cancer. They were like oxygen to me when I couldn't breathe. I saw the profound effect of sharing your story and how that would lead to a deeper bond with others who are also battling something similar. I decided in that moment I needed to get well so I could pass the torch of hope on to others, like so many cancer survivors did for me. The ability to be the beacon of light in someone else's darkest moments is life-changing, not only for them, but you as well. Sure, I faced countless moments of anxiety that the cancer had returned, and each time celebrating a clear scan and sigh in relief. As the first and then second year passed, I remained in remission, despite my first oncologist's poor prognosis. The years began to pass, and I distanced myself from my diagnosis more and more, yet never failing to reach out to newly diagnosed patients to be that source of support and hope. And when I hit the big 5-year mark, we celebrated. It was a huge milestone. My oncologist graduated me to annual visits. Each August 31st would represent my diagnosis date, and October would be my remission victory and marker. As I approached my 10-year remission mark, I was again reminded how precious life is in the most unfathomable way. It was October 1st, 2017. I was in Las Vegas, Nevada, attending the last day of the Route 91 Music Festival. By the end of the night, it would be the worst shooting massacre in the history of the United States. 58 people killed, and over 800 injured. As the first few shots rang out, confusion settled over the crowd of 22,000 people. Suddenly, I felt like what was a huge explosion and searing pain on my face. And then the horrible sound registered, automatic gunfire. I realized I had just been shot in the face and we were now under direct gunfire. In a split second, I went from dancing to the music to being shot. My face felt like it was on fire. And I knew I sustained a severe gunshot wound to the left side of my face. A stranger behind me offered her shirt to hold to help with the bleeding as we lay down and bullets rained down on us. I knew my injuries were critical, but I also knew what fighting for my life looked like. And I thought, there is no way that I've survived 10 years of remission to die here tonight. I thought of my husband back in our hotel room and knew that I needed to get to him. I also knew I did not have the luxury of falling apart, that my survival depended on staying calm and getting to safety. Chaos continued around us. People screamed and cried. And during a brief reprieve of gunfire, we decided to run to the next cover spot. As I got up to run, I saw for the first time the full carnage around me. There are no previous life experiences to prepare you for being on an open field, under gunfire, with innocent people being so violently killed around you. I passed an immense amount of tragedy on that field, and it nearly killed me to keep running past the people who were lifeless. Someone's child, someone's spouse, someone's parent, someone. I knew that these people I passed had already been killed, and the magnitude of it hit me as the next round of gunfire began, and we took cover the best we could. We ran to a fenced area, and a kind stranger lifted me up and over to take cover as the next volley of bullets began. I looked across the way as another lifeless body slumped in front of me. I borrowed a stranger's phone to text my husband that I loved him. The next break in gunfire, we ran through a fence that had been pushed over by the thousands of people trying to escape, and we spilled onto a side street that backed up to the employee entrance of the Tropicana Hotel. We had been under gunfire for 10 minutes, the longest 10 minutes of my life. Thousands of people poured onto the street, fleeing for their life. The gravity of the situation became more intense as I looked for help. I followed crowds into the Tropicana Hotel. I had no idea what I looked like, but as people saw me, they stepped aside, and the fear that registered in their faces by my appearance made my heart skip a beat. I was taken to a back room they were doing triage in. An EMT, a probation officer, an orthopedic surgeon, and his wife, a surgical nurse, had all been at the concert and were now helping to take care of the wounded. It was as if God had assembled the A-team for me in my darkest hour. They stabilized me as we awaited for help. They tried to help control bleeding and maintain my airway. They used supplies from an ambulance to start an IV, and the room at one point was even guarded by other concert attendees as rumors began of bombs in the hotel and additional shooters. I asked someone to call my husband, and I still remember their shock as I painfully, yet calmly, rattled off his number by heart. The left side of my face was partially paralyzed, and it made it difficult to speak. My husband's voice came on the line, and he assured me he would get to me. He would find me. An ambulance arrived and loaded three of us in. A man with a gunshot wound to his leg sat behind me in the gurney I was loaded in on. He helped hold pressure to my face and talked to me the whole way to the hospital. "It's going to be okay, Natalie. We're going to make it. You're going to live, Natalie," he told me. "We're slowing down. We're almost to the hospital, Natalie. Hang in there." One of my last conscious memories was arriving to the emergency room and being told that my airway was no longer secure and starting to close. I was told that I needed to be intubated immediately. I came to about 30 minutes later in a hallway. I'd been given a paralytic, but not completely sedated. I could not move, but I was extremely aware of my surroundings. The beep of the machine breathing for me sounded off. I struggled to breathe, to take a deep breath. Instead, it felt like I was slowly suffocating. I could not move, and complete fear set in. I wondered if I was in a coma. Did they still know I was in here? Was I shot worse than I initially thought? Why couldn't I move? It was extremely disorienting to be so aware on one level, yet completely unable to respond. I then heard my husband's voice and desperately tried to make myself respond to him, but my body wouldn't listen. The medication had completely paralyzed me, and yet my mind was painfully aware of everything going on around me. My husband Jason later told me that when he arrived at the hospital, they could not locate me in the chaos. Everyone was registered with their first name and given the last name Trauma. So I was Natalie Trauma, but they couldn't find me. He said a bed rolled by. Someone was soaked in blood, their clothes partially cut off. He said part of their face looked as if a grenade had exploded from the inside out, and a tube was coming out of their mouth, breathing for them. As they turned the corner, he recognized a braid I had done in my hair earlier that night, and that is how he found me. I would go on to spend the next 4 days in ICU at Sunrise Hospital in Las Vegas. I had lost a third of my blood supply and needed an emergency blood transfusion. I was intubated for 3 days and then given a tracheotomy to keep my airway open and help me breathe. I was unable to talk or communicate, and writing at this point was very difficult due to the heavy amount of drugs I was under. Jason and my family were given the news that my left jaw had been destroyed on impact from the bullet, and my chin had split in two. The two major nerves that run along the jawline had been destroyed. One of these nerves controls feeling, and the other controls movement. So I had essentially lost feeling and sensation on the left lower side of my face. And in addition, the motory nerve being severed had caused loss of movement and control of the left lower portion. My first surgery was done to clean out the debris, bullet fragments, and bone fragments from my jaw. My jaw was wired shut to stabilize my severe injury. Surgeons were unable to close the wound on my face due to too much soft tissue and skin loss. A feeding tube was also placed, and I was no longer able to take food or fluids by mouth. One of Jason's immediate thoughts once he found me was he wanted to get me home. And this instinct was fueled even more when he was told how long my recovery would be and how many surgeries I would need. From this internal instinct grew a plan propelled by family, friends, strangers, and many of you here tonight to make possible. And on Thursday, October 4th, I was put on an air ambulance and flown to John Wayne Airport where I was transported by ambulance to Mission Viejo Mission Hospital. I would undergo a second surgery within 24 hours of arriving at Mission Hospital to further clean out the bullet fragments. They placed 3 titanium plates in my face, 2 titanium plates to hold together where my jaw should have been, and another titanium plate for my chin where it had fractured in half. Not being able to communicate was an extremely frustrating part for me. I was completely reliant on others to understand my crazy hand gestures and motions. At times, I pretended I knew sign language, which I didn't. Luckily, the amazing ICU nurses and my family and friends often anticipated my needs even before I had them. And as I started to come out of medical sedation drugs, I refused to let my family leave me and insisted on someone staying the night with me every night. Thank you, Aunt Sharon, and my moms, and all the people here tonight that did that, because those were long nights. But I was terrified. Even when I was under sedation, my heart was elevated, and I would require anxiety medications to keep it under control. My third surgery came several days later to attempt to close the severe facial wounds. Doctors created a skin flap from behind my neck and harvested skin tissue to close the wound. They also, God love those plastic surgeons, moved my 6-inch scar to my jawline to help conceal it. And on the 17th day of being in ICU, my tracheotomy tube was removed, and through a wired shut jaw, I was able to attempt my first words. "Thank you," I said to the medical staff surrounding me. We were finally able to start planning my discharge date. I was so excited. I had been in ICU for over 2 weeks. Unfortunately, the following day, a complication of bleeding came up as I started to bleed internally into my neck. Intense pressure formed on my left side, and I frantically tried to communicate with my nurse and doctor, texting my husband and my parents that something was wrong. My doctor responded to the emergency page and tried to control my bleeding at bedside, and nurses shouted out emergency procedures. I was rushed into emergency surgery that lasted 6 hours. As I returned to my room, tears streamed down my face. I was in so much pain. I couldn't even move. I couldn't speak or communicate very well. I was reduced to mumbled words. However, with those tears came determination. I would get out of this hospital bed and I would go home. And after 20 days of being hospitalized and 4 surgeries, I was finally given the all clear that I would be discharged. And to make it even more special, it was on Shabbat. I had been gone from my home for 23 days at this point. I had left in September, carefree, healthy. And now here I was returning towards the end of October with a feeding tube, my jaw wired shut, and a completely different person. The slightest sound made me jump. I distrusted anyone I didn't know. I was scared to be left alone. I felt so disconnected from the world and everyone around me. I had such a long row ahead of me, and I knew that it wasn't gonna be easy. My surgeons had explained to Jason and I that not only would I need multiple surgeries over the next 2 years, but that the 2 nerves that had controlled movement and sensation in my left lower face had been destroyed. They were unable to predict the outcome of regaining movement or sensation. I refused to give up hope, and right then and there, I committed to doing everything in my power to rebuild my life. It's been almost 17 months since the shooting. I've had 9 surgeries, 4 different hospital stays, and I will likely have my 10th surgery next month. My jaw's been wired shut twice now, 8 weeks the first time, 6 weeks the second time. The longest and most grueling surgery was last March, a 7-hour surgery that was critical in my recovery. They took bone and harvested it from my hip to rebuild my jaw. They built a bone graft out of titanium mesh plate to place in my jaw. A nerve graft was done by transplanting a nerve from my leg to reconnect my sensory nerve. In July, I had my 8th surgery, when they removed a nerve from my other leg to hopefully reconnect my motory nerve. The success rates can vary, and they can take years to show any results. I have been painstakingly put together again by many talented and dedicated doctors who have described this process as literally stretching the limits of biology. While the physical components of my recovery have been difficult, the emotional struggles have been just as challenging. I really wish I could stand up here today and say, I never questioned God or asked countless questions on how to make sense of this tragedy. To witness so much violence and destruction had changed me. Having faith and believing is easy when life is going great. However, I will be honest, this rocked my faith. My survivor's guilt was paralyzing. I felt like my heart and faith had been shattered into thousands of pieces. I didn't know how or if I could even piece it back together again. Countless strangers, families, and friends have told me, I am a miracle saved by God. And upon hearing this, my heart would instantly drop and my throat would start to constrict. These kind and loving words became so dreaded. How could I view myself as a miracle when I had ran past those who did not make it? Were they not worthy of miracles? Why did God save me and not them? That was my big question, and I would ask it with devastation in my heart. I told myself I should just be grateful to be alive, and here I am having the audacity to raise such questions. But I have come to realize that night is so much bigger than me or the other 22,000 people from that night. That night, one person showed evil. And since then, hundreds of thousands have shown love. Where tragedy struck, kindness erupted. From the moment I was shot, strangers, family, and friends emerged to help me. It has taught me to never underestimate the impact you are capable of making in someone's life. Sometimes, restoring faith comes in the form of humanity. I've come to appreciate that our lives are built on adversity. Each of us is made up of the challenges and obstacles we have faced. We each have our own story, what life has unfairly handed us, and how we have chosen to react. Having cancer 11 years ago gave me the coping skills to tackle anything, to face fear head on, and also to realize the immense power one has in adjusting their mindset in the midst of tragedy. My surviving the unsurvivable has only connected me deeper to my ability of perseverance. And I realized I will not be able to piece together myself the same again, ever again. And more importantly, I don't have to. I am collectively held together by the love and support of family and friends. Almost dying that night has become a physical and daily reminder to cherish the beautiful gift of life. We are not given promises that it will be easy or without challenge. I can say that through my own personal life experiences, I have even more reason to find joy where there was loss, love where there was hate, and understanding where there was judgment. This is my life. This is my story. And as for our Torah portion, Ki Tisa, I learned from Rabbi that the broken tablets that contain the Ten Commandments, the very sacred makeup of our morale and our heart, were placed alongside with the whole tablets in the Ark. Put together, the brokenness of hurt, pain, and suffering brought together with the completed holy version to make a wholeness between the two. The past stored with the future to help bring light to the present. Just as my life has been broken and scattered by a life-threatening disease and a tragic event, I too have been put back together with the broken parts and the new parts to make my life whole again. The very words Ki Tisa itself mean rise up. This ancient Torah reading strongly parallels events and circumstances that have happened in my life. How many of us struggle to find meaning after a tragedy or a traumatic event in our own lives? We search for the reasons and struggle to move forward. Rabbi Goldfarb has taught me through this Torah portion that when life seems to break you, you search for wholeness to feel complete again. It is in the embracing of the beautiful life that we are given, all of the broken and whole parts, that ultimately complete us. Shabbat Shalom.
Natalie, thank you so much for sharing so beautifully and bravely your experiences. I think I can say for all of us that your words have touched our hearts in ways that are hard for us to express, and how you have faced what you have faced and the nightmare you have faced is truly an example for us to learn to treasure as you have the fragility of life, but to respond to those challenges with the Jewish response, l'chaim, to life. Knowing this would be powerful and emotional, our cantor has selected a special song of tribute for you, but for all of us as well.
Splinters that you carry, the pain you left behind. Come healing of the body, come healing of the mind. And let the heavens hear it, Refa'inu Adonai. Come healing of the body, come healing of the mind. Dust concealing an undivided love, the heart beneath is teaching to the broken heart above. Oh, see the darkness yielding that tore the light apart. Come healing of the reason, come healing. Let the earth proclaim, come healing of our spirit, come healing of our name. O longing of the branches to lift the little bud, O longing of the arteries to purify the blood, and let the heavens give it, Refa'inu. Let the heavens hear it, Refa'inu Adonai. Come healing of the body, come healing of the mind.
Sorry. It's okay.